Hi friends, welcome back to the channel and welcome back to the series where we are solving some really good problems from the topic of mechanics of materials or solid mechanics. This question was asked in GATE 2020 mechanical engineering paper. So here we have a truss and it is loaded as shown over here. They are asking us what is the smallest value of this force P at which any of the truss members will buckle. So the key thing is you should first appreciate that all these are pin joints. So if you consider this as a column which is undergoing some kind of compressive loading, which we don't know, but we will get to that a bit later. But if this is the column and this is having a compressive force acting on this member, then the first thing is the boundary condition corresponding to this column is pinned. Makes sense? Because that will help us down the line when we solve this problem. The rest of the things are far more easy. The step one is find the force in terms of P and all these quantities. What will be the force acting in this member AC, whether it is compressive, or find out what are the members in the truss that undergoes a compressive load. So as a first step, what we do is we assume that every member is in tension. That's a good way to start. So I'm showing the right corner. So you can see I'm assuming all these members are in tension, and this is the external forces acting on the joint. So everything has to be in equilibrium. So this joint also has to be in equilibrium. Imposing this criteria, we can solve for the tension forces acting in this member and in this member. So going ahead, so this force will be, I can call it as RAB, and I can call this force as RBC. I can solve for these two unknowns because I have two equations. The first equation is summation of forces in the x direction has to be zero, and then summation of forces in the y direction also has to be zero. So I have these two equations, and then I can solve for these two unknowns. So here I have shown that so after imposing those two equations, you will arrive here. The reaction force in the member AB will look like this, and RBZ looks like this. Good to go. So since these quantities are assuming positive value, our initial assumption holds good. Our initial assumption was each of those links, link AB and link BC, was in tension. So that assumption holds true. Step two. Now we can exploit the symmetry of the structure and see I know these two members are in tension with certain force, with certain axial force acting on them. It is P by root 2 if I'm right. Then similarly, these two members are also in tension because the structure is symmetric about this particular axis. So I know what is the axial force acting over here, and I know the axial force acting in this member as well. Now let's apply the equilibrium equations to this joint A, so that we can get the axial force that acts in this member AC. The picture looks a little bit clumsy, but I think that will be this will give you all details regarding the joint A. So this is the joint A that we are talking about. So I have shown the free body diagram of all the truss members that are connected to that point capital A. So as you can see over here, this is already not to us. This member DA member is already in tension with a force P by root 2. This member AB is also in tension with a force P by root 2. Now we don't know about the member CA, so we assume that it is in tension, and the tension force acting in that member, let it be RCA. So now we have drawn the free body diagram of all the three members. Now correspondingly, we can draw the free body diagram of the joint A. So as you can see here, Baruto is acting over here because you assume this member is in tension over here. Or similarly, you can assume that RCA is acting like this because we assume that our member CA is in tension. Then P/√2 is coming from this member. Imposing again the equations of equilibrium for the joint A as shown over here, we get the value of RAC. RAC is assuming a value of minus P, which means that our initial assumption that AC is in tension is wrong. So we initially assume that this member AC is in tension, but since you have a negative sign for the reaction in the joint or the axial force in the joint, that means, which means that your AC is in compression. So this member is in compression with a force P acting all through it. This is how the free body diagram will look like for the whole system. Now we have this particular member which is undergoing a compressive force, which in turn means that this is the one which will buckle as you pull from the both sides. From the theory of buckling, you know that these are the four different boundary conditions that you can have. So here I have shown a pin, then this is fixed, this is fixed free, and this is fixed pinned. I have shown the deformation shape here so that it gives you a better feel regarding the boundary conditions. As you can see over here the displacement is constrained but rotation is allowed. But when you have a fixed condition on both ends, your displacements are fixed as well as the slope of the curve. Make sense? Here we have no constraint because it's a free end, and at this end we have both the displacement as well as the slope constraint, and this is again a fixed free. So here your both displacement and slope is constrained, but here only displacement is constrained. You are allowing the slope to assume whatever value it can take. A little bit of appreciation will tell you which one will be the highest crippling load. Obviously this one, because this looks a lot more stable. That's why I among all the four, this has the highest crippling load for given by 4 pi square a divided by l square. And next, what next? The next will be this one, because you are maintaining this fixed condition here also, but you are introducing a pin joint at one end. So the crippling load reduces, and instead of 4 we have a 2 here, so the crippling load is becoming half compared to this case. Then what next? Then this thing, pin, you are replacing this joint also with a pin joint. Again, there is a reduction in the crippling load by another half factor. So it comes down to something like pi square a divided by l square. The next constraint, you are making it free. That means the crippling load is far more less now. It is only 1/4 of what we had in this pin case. So I wanted to just give you this slide also, this piece of information also. This is very well known, but I thought it will be just good to revise. Our case, our equation, or our that AC member falls to this category because in a truss all joints are pin joints. So this is the equation which we have to use for the AC member in our problem. Now everything is in place because you know the physics, you have all your formulae, the rest of things are simply plug and check, as I always say, and that is fairly easy also. So let's go over here. So this is the free body diagram. The flexural rigidity is given by 4EI. There is a force acting capital P, the length is √2L. Crippling load is given by this formula. You can plug in all these things. Then you will get your crippling load. Crippling load will amount to 2 pi square a divided by l square. So that's it. That's the answer. That's a crippling load. So when the P becomes equal to P equals to 2 pi square a divided, there is no square over here, by P 2 pi square a divided by l square, the AC member will buckle. So that's it. Thanks for watching.